Welcome back to Moonlight Movies, and it is late August.
It is.
And for us, that means we start thinking about, wow, we're behind on getting ready for Halloween. like, this is when I'm like, I don't have a costume yet? What's going on?
No, I know. What are we going to do? I have no idea.
So, yeah, we're already getting in Halloween mood. So that, for us, means a lot of movies we're going to be watching. All the way from now through through Halloween and a little bit after.
Yeah, we usually carry it over. Actually, yeah. we'll have Halloweens in June and March. We
go back to Halloween sometimes throughout the year.
Yeah.
We love Halloween. That means two kinds of movies, really. It means movies about Halloween, whether they're like kids' movies or just comedy stuff. Yep. But it also, of course, means horror movies.
Yes, and look at what we got today.
This is to us anyway, a classic.
Yes.
This is two classics. Right?
Two classics.
Well, yeah. One of them more so.
Yeah, yeah.
This is Waxwork and Waxwork 2, Lost in Time, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Yep.
I always get that confused with Beastmaster 2, which I think is Through the Portal of Time. But
yeah. Well, we've seen part one more than
But we've seen them both a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, because these, especially the first, one of our all-time favorite horror movies,
wouldn't you say?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah, Waxwork and Waxwork 2, and we're going to talk about them right now. And I do want to say, for me, with Waxwork, it was kind of a big deal when I was a kid, because when it came out on VHS, they actually put out two versions.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the first times I remember this happening. They put out the regular one, the R-rated,
mm-hmm.
but they also had the unrated version.
Oh,
so that was kind of like, ooh,
that's
did you rent the unrated version?
Wow.
You know, and I don't think I had even seen it yet, but eventually got hooked on it.
Yeah.
And this DVD is pretty much the only DVD I know of for these two movies. I think it's the only one ever released. I have no idea if this is the unrated version. I don't know. I don't know if I've seen.
It seems pretty tame.
Well, it's got some gory stuff, though. It's got some gore.
That's true.
But I don't know how far the unrated one goes. Actually, one of the reasons I wanted to review this is it's coming out on Blu-ray. October 17th.
Yes.
Waxwork, and it's going to be just like this. It's going to be both movies. The cover, I think, is like the same
deal. So you guys have to run out and get this, please.
You got to get this in October on Blu-ray. And it's going to be a limited edition Blu-ray, so it's only going to be out for a while, I guess, until they run out. And it's Blu-ray, so it'll probably be widescreen, which these movies on this DVD, are full screen, which is a crime, as we all know now. We used to be fine with it, but now we know.
Yeah.
Full screen is, well, that's old news. But yeah, so Blu-ray is the way to get this, and the Blu-ray is going to be the unrated cut. So we'll find out then if we've been watching the unrated or if we've been watching the
That'll
R.
That'll be interesting.
This actually, it says R, so this is not the unrated one.
I guess not.
So I guess it's going to be more gory than this. And this is actually a little bit gory, I thought.
I didn't.
A little bit. Well, it's going to be... I'm squeamish about gore. I watch really gory stuff, but I'm squeamish. But yeah, so this is the R-rated. Blu-ray, October 17th, unrated cut, and it is a double feature, and it should be widescreen.
You should really check it out. Even if you haven't seen it before, just go buy it.
Yeah. So, let's talk about Waxwork and Waxwork 2. We'll start with Waxwork. Waxwork 2, we'll get to that later. But we're going to do, this is going to be all spoilers and stuff. We do all the spoilers. We just kind of run through the whole thing. So,
How do we start?
Before we go into all the spoilers and stuff, you know, we can tell you right off the bat, if you don't want to watch spoilers, we're recommending this. You got a recommendation to see this
definitely.
Movie.
Definitely. And it's a quirky horror film. It's definitely,
you said it was like kind of David Lynch-y in the style.
Oh,
not in the movie, but the style.
Well, and the fact is, I mean, the reason for that is because the director throws in these, it's just basically kind of a mix of 80s and 50s.
Yeah, it's got that it's kind of got a film noir 1950s vibe.
Yeah, all of the actors are dressed in kind of 50s style clothing.
Yeah,
especially the female lead. She's definitely decked out in kind of the 50s, the 50s innocent look.
Yeah, well, let's get into the plot. Okay, spoiler alert, we're getting into it.
Yes.
Okay, so this film is about a guy named Mark.
Yes.
Played by Zach Galligan.
Yay, Zach Galligan!
From Gremlins. Woo! So this is a Gremlins figure. It's not a wax. There are no Waxwork action figures. But this is Zach Galligan. We met him. He's a really nice guy.
He's
met him at the Alamo Draft House. Mm-hmm. We were seeing Gremlins at the time, but we have seen Waxwork
there.
He's
very cool.
Yeah.
Very nice.
So anyway, he is the lead in this film and in the sequel. And he is sort of a preppy kind of guy. This is basically a group of preppy kids, but they're not jerks or any. Well,
they're old money. Definitely old money.
China is kind of a jerk.
Yeah, she's.
I mean, you know, they're likable. But anyway, so Mark is the main one.
Mm-hmm.
And in the beginning of the film, we see him at home and how he's. You know, he tries to be a pretty great guy.
He's struggling with his mother.
He doesn't want to be one of these, like, preppy jerks.
No, he doesn't.
He's friends with the butler and all that. So he's
trying
that kind
to grow
of guy.
Up, you can tell.
Yeah, and he tries to be down with the people.
Yeah.
So he goes off for a day at college. Yep. And then we are introduced to two of his friends, mm-hmm. which are two girls, China and Sarah.
Yes.
You want to
describe
them?
China is, she likes to think of herself as a very mature girl.
Oh, yeah.
She
edgy,
yeah,
in a
edgy,
mature,
mature in a,
sees that as being mature.
Exactly.
Being edgy.
Sarah is very innocent.
She's the virgin of the group.
Mm-hmm,
well,
right.
I don't even know why I did that, because she is a virgin.
She is a virgin, yeah.
Okay, so, and China likes to get around because she thinks that's being a mature, mm-hmm. grown-up woman. She sort of wants to be very international.
Yes,
and,
yes.
Yeah, that kind of.
A woman of the world.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So, the thing about China is that Mark wants China.
Yeah.
And they've had their thing, I guess.
I mean, I wouldn't say that he likes her, but as he said in the movie, he wants what he can't get.
Yeah, he that's how he describes it a little bit later on. But
mm-hmm.
at first, you just see him, like, struggling with the fact that she's kind of rejected him.
Mm-hmm.
And,
which annoys anybody. So,
sort of considers him, even though he's a rich, preppy mm-hmm. guy, you know, she wants something
more. She called him
more,
a slob.
Yeah,
a
but she's
slob.
Looking for more of an... most interesting man in the world thing.
Yeah, yeah.
that kind of mm-hmm. older man who travels the world mm-hmm. and is very...
She likes the Fabio guy.
Well, she likes that also.
Apparently later on.
She likes that, but she also likes the older, sophisticated man type.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, so the two girls are walking to college,
mm-hmm.
and they're going down a neighborhood sidewalk. And in the middle of the neighborhood, randomly, is a big fancy... building that I guess they've never seen before, and it's a waxwork. It's a waxwork,
mm-hmm.
and they're like, "This is a weird place for
a
waxwork."
Exactly, and they comment on it, and she goes, "Ooh, scary."
Yeah. and so they're talking about it, and then all of a sudden, just appears out of nowhere, David Warner, the greatest actor of our time.
Exactly.
Well,
I love
we say
David
that
Warner.
Of a lot of people, but
he's
one of them.
He's in everything. He
he's
pops
wonderful.
Up in everything.
He's in,
amazing.
Yeah, I really love and respect actors who seem like they won't turn down a job.
Yeah, why not? I mean,
they're actors, you know? They're
like
real
this.
Actors, yeah. So David Warner, you know, just appears there, and he's the guy who runs the wax. He's like Willy Wonka.
Yeah. Oh.
Evil.
Completely
evil Willy
dressed
Wonka.
Like Willy Wonka.
Yeah, purple coat.
It was
and
crazy.
Yeah, and he's just sort of, you know, he invites them
mm-hmm.
to come to a special, like, early opening of the waxwork just for a small group of people.
At midnight,
and the small group of people just turns out to be them.
Exactly.
and a few others. He says, how he says,
what
like,
did she say? After
bring
dinner,
a few
before
others,
but, breakfast?
Bring a few others, no more than six, right?
No more than six. That's
okay,
right.
So who... So, well, they end up bringing Mark and their three other friends.
Right.
Who we're introduced right after that to the three other friends at
mm-hmm.
college, which are Tony,
mm-hmm.
who is sort of a comic relief guy.
Yeah.
Not a dorky type, another preppy looking guy, but a fun, likable
exactly.
guy. And the couple, who is James, who's like a horror film buff, and Gemma, his girlfriend,
mm-hmm.
who I... don't know how to describe Gemma except she's James's girlfriend.
Yeah, I mean, that's all she is.
And I mean, she was fine in the part, but that's what she was.
And I mean, Tony, I've seen Tony before. He's in Twin Peaks.
Tony's from Twin Peaks.
I believe his name is Dana Ashbrook, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right about that. Yeah.
But he's really funny in this.
Yeah. China, I don't. Oh, what is China? I'm going to look at the DVD box. China's Michelle Johnson.
Okay. Yeah, and I know her from Far and Away.
I had a thing for her when I was a kid.
Oh, really?
Because she was in a movie. So I was a kid back in the day where you're a little kid and you would like sneak in over and watch HBO and Cinemax because there was movies and stuff.
Yeah.
And she was very young at the time, but she was in a movie where she was the daughter of Michael Caine's best friend.
Michael Caine?
And she has an affair with Michael Caine. And it's one of those beach sex comedies, but a little bit more mature because it's Michael Caine. It's called Blame It on Rio.
Oh,
anyway,
okay.
she shows her bits and pieces in that movie. And I remember I had a crush on her since I was a kid because of that movie. And she was also the lead female in the TV show Werewolf, which is like one of my favorite TV shows. Just in like the pilot. But anyway.
I haven't seen that one.
Yeah. So she's kind of, she's a recognizable
face. She's established.
Face. Yeah. So there's Sarah. I don't know her from anything else, but
I feel like I've seen her in something else, but I don't remember. But anyway, so we've got these six friends.
Six friends.
Yep.
And they show up that evening to go to the waxwork.
James and Gemma, they chicken out.
Oh, they cut out. They chicken out. Yeah.
Because Gemma says it doesn't feel right, guys.
Mm-hmm.
So she.
Yeah. So it's just Mark and mm-hmm. China, Sarah, and Tony.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see. They go. They show up. It's weird. They're the only ones there.
Right.
There's a giant type guy and there's a dwarf.
Yeah.
And they're the ones who let them in. They're sort of like a couple of butler type guys.
Mm-hmm.
And. So does David Warner show up there and let them in also?
No, I don't think he
doesn't
shows
even
up
show
yet.
Up
no,
there?
No.
Okay, well, they go on in to see the waxwork. And so they're like wandering around through the waxworks, and it's like really a horror-themed waxworks.
Yes, it is.
And not really movies. Supposedly these are scenes of like authentic stuff.
Lots of really creepy images. There's this one image that always freaks me out because it's kind of suggestive as well. It's this, the guy.
Yeah, it's this guy. Some guy from the, it's the
like
Invisible Man.
Invisible Man.
Yeah, because he's all, the only way you know that is he's bandaged up. And he's got a girl down on her knees next to a car, and he's forcing her, or he's about to force her to.
Like feeding her
take
the gas
take
tank.
The gas hose into her mouth.
Right. And and it's all 1920s style. It's really
and that's one of the scenes.
And the music plays into it. Whoever did the soundtrack in this movie, I mean.
Yeah, well, they use
really
a lot
good,
of old
really
old music too. They use
but
like
the actual,
Benny Goodman
like,
and stuff like that.
But the
too.
Actual soundtrack, I mean, that was.
Oh yeah, good. That's true. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a good, good score on that. But yeah, there's various horror scenes. And they're reminiscent of certain movies, like you've got the Phantom of the Opera, and you've got a vampire scene, and a werewolf scene.
Mm-hmm.
But of course they're sort of presented as if these are like, just horrific scenes.
You got Little Shop of Horrors too.
Little Shop, they're obviously inspired by movies. And I think David Warner does show up there.
I don't remember him showing up, but maybe.
David Warner has this thing where he likes to sort of push you into the scene.
They're all walking around and looking at the,
I guess they just wander.
Yeah, they're just wandering around right now.
In this first part, Mark, Tony, the comic relief guy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he's looking at the werewolf scene.
Right. Okay. And he's trying to light a match.
He's got his cigarette in his mouth.
And somehow he flicks his lighter into the scene, into the exhibit. And he's like, they would be okay with me going in for my lighter. By the way, there's ropes over, keeping people out.
Yeah, it's typical,
typical museum.
Display roped off.
And so he steps inside and
crosses the ropes.
Crosses over into another world.
All of a sudden, he's inside the scene.
Yes.
that is laid out there. So all of a sudden he's in this dark forest, mm-hmm. and it's creepy. It's really creepy.
And he thinks he's tripping out.
Yeah.
I mean,
who put the acid in my drink again?
China.
Yeah.
I love that line.
He thinks he's been slipped a Mickey there.
Yeah.
So he's inside this world all of a sudden, and who shows up? Well, there's a cabin. He goes into the cabin.
Yes.
Who's in there? But Indiana Jones's buddy, Sala.
Sala.
Which emphasized how much certain aspects of this are like the show Sliders.
Sliders.
Because they're like going into these worlds. And so Sala is in there, and Sala's freaking out because mm-hmm. he's about to turn into a werewolf. So,
Tony doesn't really quite get what's going on. He just thinks he's a jerk.
He thinks he's been hypnotized or something.
Yeah, yeah.
And he keeps saying, hypnotist, make this guy more friendly.
Yeah, make this guy a little more friendly.
So, Sala, I know his name, John Rhys Davies is his mm-hmm. name. He's starting to transform into a werewolf, mm-hmm. and...
Then the werewolf hunters come in, and it's just like this big, like a classic werewolf.
It's a disaster. It's a horror show.
And what does he end up, Sala ends up, like, scratching him or something?
Biting or scratching him, and then the hunters shoot Sala, but then Tony starts to turn into a werewolf himself, and he gets shot.
Yeah.
And, freeze frame, end scene.
That is how the exhibit stays. So anybody on the outside, that is what they see.
Yeah, all of a sudden, just boom, there's another character in the exhibit who is Tony turning into a werewolf. So there's this added person there.
Which is super lucky that the other people weren't looking at that time. Yeah.
They would have seen this person just
there's
appear
like a
there.
blue electricity.
Yeah, it's
electricity thing.
Yeah, it's old school effects, but they work.
It's awesome.
They totally
are
fine.
I'm all about old school. Always old school.
Oh, but it looks fine. It's fine for this movie. And then other people are looking around, and they're the other guys, the other gang, mm-hmm. part of the group.
And then we come to China.
Oh yeah.
And China is looking around, and she comes across this.
This
Fabio type guy.
it's a vampire scene, although it doesn't really, it's not obvious, like, is it?
It
looks like a romance novel.
Yeah, it looks straight out of a romance novel. And I feel like he's crouching over a body or something.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's how he looks, and she, of course, is very interested, and she decides to step into the exhibit. I don't know why you would do that, but she does. And then immediately she's transported into this other
in the scene. The scene is real all of mm-hmm. a sudden. She's,
she's in this other world.
It's this castle,
mm-hmm.
and
she's really
brought
know
in
what's going on, 'cause I don't
for
think
dinner.
This is the kind of chick who sees a lot of horror films.
Maybe. No, she probably doesn't know. Mm-hmm. And there's this
long
dining room table, all these people around it.
Yeah.
And at the head of the table is this guy who has to be a model from romance novels.
I swear
novels.
I've seen him.
On
Walmart.
Romance.
Before, I don't know.
Yeah. So he's at the head of the table, and he's like, come on in.
Yeah.
And sit down,
have
a seat.
Some dinner.
And there are a few other girls around the table, and they're mm-hmm. all whacked out, clearly.
Yes.
And then there's this other guy who apparently is his son.
Who's also kind of whacked out.
Yeah.
They're all whacked out. And he offers her some dinner, and she... is served this plate of bloody chunks of meat, which, I mean, I love rare meat. But
she thinks it's
steak tartare. Yeah.
And
there's a big joke about it.
Yeah.
And then they finish dinner, and the other people are eating their dinner, and they're so ravenous about it and very animalistic.
Yeah, they're just slopping it up.
Yeah. And then they finish dinner, and he sends her off to bed, and...
She ate that whole bowl of
meat, steak tartare.
And we find out later where it came from, and it's gross.
Yeah, so she decides to...
to what? Does she...
Oh, no,
she's in her room.
Yeah,
and
the
sun shows up
tries to seduce her, but at the same time, he kind of tries to bite her as
Yeah, he reveals right away
he's a vampire,
and she freaks out and runs out mm-hmm. of the room.
And then she stumbles all over the house and runs into the kitchen, and that's where she finds... her fiancé with his...
Oh, okay. The reason it's her fiancé is because when you go into these scenes, you become a character.
You become that character.
In that
you
scene.
You become that person.
And you know that it's, you don't know what's going on. You're like, you know, why are you calling me this? But you
right.
know,
she was really confused, of
yeah.
course.
They're calling you by a name. It's not your name. Mm-hmm. You're a character in the scene. And so, yeah, her character has a fiance, and this fiance is on this table with his leg
right.
totally stripped of the meat, and
yes.
it's like just a bloody bone, and he's there on the table, and he's alive, and he's
trying to explain to her that these people are vampires, and they're going to kill her,
yeah.
and he's trying to explain how to kill a vampire to her so she's prepared. And I also think it's important to say that... depending on how willing you are to believe in your situation in these scenarios,
they figure that out later, but
that's going
to
show whether you survive
or
not.
Yeah.
And I don't think that China really believed it. It seemed like she was kind of like, what the hell is going on? You know what I mean? She was like, this is weird.
Well, yeah, but I don't think she...
I think once she started killing the vampires, maybe she started to believe it.
Mm.
She starts getting attacked by the three other women who were at the dinner table. They are also vampires as
yeah.
well. And then
and she holds her own really well.
She
yeah.
does. She's like freaking
basically,
Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Yeah, she basically takes
really
all
good.
Of them out.
Yeah. But then, of course, she has always had this idea, this romanticized idea about this
perfect
this
guy.
Perfect guy, and who ends up killing her but this perfect guy.
Well,
and not killing her, but...
making her a vampire, yeah.
yeah. So,
especially now that
so
he's out of brides.
So Fabio dude shows up and bites her.
With no trouble
seductively,
whatsoever.
Though, so I guess she was happy.
Well,
she
yeah.
seemed into it. Whatever.
But then, so, yeah, Tony's out. China's out.
China's out.
Mark is wandering
Mark
around.
Sarah
is staring intensely at the
Marquis
de Sade
exhibit, which
display.
We will revisit later.
Yeah. And they end up...
they end up going home because they can't find their friends anymore.
Yeah.
So yeah, they end up walking home. Mark takes her home. And we see her getting dropped off at this really nice apartment complex, which we'll talk about later how interesting and strange this whole thing is.
Yeah, because
anyway, their choices in part two were a little
things
weird.
All and it's the same director, Anthony Hickox,
mm-hmm.
And he wrote and directed mm-hmm. both films, but yeah.
But let's just say now that this exterior of her apartment complex was really nice. And,
it seemed, well, and it was big anyway.
She's also dressed really nice.
She dresses
nicely,
really nicely.
50s clothes, super cute. Definitely not slow.
Yeah, and she's very attractive for the most part, except
yes.
for when she does this really big smile and she's got the TMG.
Oh,
you know, the TMG.
That's a problem of his. Yeah.
Too much gum.
Yeah.
But otherwise she's pretty cute. She's kind of trying to, or Mark kind of tries to get with her. I guess
yeah.
he's figuring he's not going to get China.
Yeah, he's kind
he's
of on the rebound.
Moves in on her and she's kind of like, you're not really what I'm looking for.
Which, it's only because she saw this Marquis de Sade exhibit like
well,
5 seconds ago. And she's like, oh,
she's
that's
obviously
what
got something she's into.
Yeah,
yeah,
I mean, she's into that.
Yeah, maybe Mark would be. Actually, no, he's not into that. But anyway,
I doubt it.
So they, let's see. So that was night one
mm-hmm.
of the waxwork. And then the next day...
we see Mark on the telephone.
He's trying to find his friends.
You can tell how many times we've seen this movie.
Yeah.
You see Mark on the telephone, and he's contacting China's parents, and he's contacting Tony's house as well. And did he even call... we didn't talk about this before, but China was dating some other guy.
There's a football player that China has started
dating.
So it's sort of the rival from Mark.
Yeah, and anyway, so maybe she was over there.
Well, everybody's talking about where's China
yeah.
and where's Tony.
Mm-hmm.
So even
the other two friends, James and Gemma, they're like, oh, well, you know, they probably just got a hotel room together or something.
Yeah, she's probably with the football player.
Yeah.
And,
well, they were talking about her.
Oh, they
Tony
said that she probably
together.
Went with
yeah,
the,
with Tony. Off.
Oh, well, that's because when they were leaving the waxwork, the dwarf told them that
they
seemed very, very into each other when they left.
I didn't hear that.
Okay. So, yeah.
Where are we? It's a long
time. So everybody's wondering where everybody is.
Yes.
And The I'm trying to think of who the third kill is. Is it the football player guy or is it the cop?
It's the football player guy.
Okay, the football player guy. So the football player guy is actually wondering where China is,
right,
too.
Right, exactly.
So that night he goes looking for her.
He calls China's house, and the mom tells him that she was at a waxwork. And actually, did he get killed the first night? He might have. Anyway.
It could have been the first night. I feel like it was the second.
Because I feel like he called that night or something. Anyway, he shows up at the waxwork, and David Warner is giving him a tour. And he all of a sudden shows this interest in one of the exhibits, the Phantom of the Opera exhibit. So this guy, I don't like to judge a book by its cover, but he doesn't seem like he's into horror films either. But
apparently, he's an okay guy. He's pretty into horror movies.
He's like really into Phantom of the Opera.
Yeah. So pretty much instantly, because we don't actually see the scene when he goes into it. We just see him stepping in, and then boom, he's a...
David Warner does his classic,
David,
would you like a closer look?
David Warner
pushes him out.
Yeah. When David Warner's around, he pushes you in, and he always says,
would you like a closer look?
Yeah.
He loves that line. It's good.
So,
He ends up turning into the victim of the Phantom of the Opera instantly. We don't see what happens.
An important thing about this is that David Warner needs a certain number of people.
And we don't know this yet. We don't quite know this yet.
But, so it's sort of a countdown when we do find out about this. I don't remember exactly when he explains that. But there are... Mark goes to the police because of his missing friends.
Mm-hmm.
So and he actually gets it is a very like classic like 80s
the cop is so reluctant
police
to
department
help him.
Thing and the whole bit where
he's
gotta,
like there's tons of missing people. I mean, I don't have time for this. Yeah. But somehow he gets him, he drags him along over to the waxwork, and so those two are over there and they're talking to David Warner, and David Warner's like, please come on in and you know, check out my place.
Reminds me of a Fright Night when...
definitely.
When you take the cop over to see the vampires coughing and all that. And it's not there.
So he goes... the cop goes in there and, you know, he doesn't see anything suspicious. However, he is making a mental note of the exhibits. Because...
When he gets back to the office and he's looking at his missing persons... all these different, like, all the different posters of, you know, I'm lost and all that stuff.
He realizes that a lot of the victims look like, the victims in the exhibits look like the...
missing people, that he's got, mm-hmm. missing cases,
so
missing files.
He's connecting all this. But anyway, so he decides to revisit the waxwork by himself later on. He thinks, at first he kind of brushed Mark off and he was like, Mark, you're a nut, you know? But he went over to the waxwork himself.
Mm-hmm.
And then Mark is doing his own thing. He goes to the college and kind of steals Sarah away from a class.
he gets fed up that the police are not going to help. So he goes over to college, gets Sarah out of class. And
of course, she's doing the innocent thing of like, mm-hmm. I can't believe it, we're going to get expelled.
Well, because he saw David Warner for the first time, you know, when he took the cop over there. And he recognized David Warner. He's about to show Sarah where he knows him from.
And so they go to his attic and they find these old newspaper clippings of how his grandfather had died, and he was murdered, right?
Yeah, his grandfather was murdered,
and
horribly.
They couldn't...
set on fire.
They never figured out how he was. The only suspicious thing that the cops found was that his manservant, I guess you would call him...
they just called him his helper. We assume
the
it's like a butler.
The house had stolen all of... or had ran off with all of... like 12 artifacts or something.
Yeah.
Because Mark's grandfather was a huge collector
of special weird artifacts.
He was totally into the occult.
He was like an occult investigator type
and he
guy.
Had a best friend, and it was Sir Wilfred.
Sir Wilfred, played by Patrick McNee.
Yes, who's awesome.
Yeah.
He's very
cool. So they go to talk to Sir Wilfred.
Yes.
But before they show that, do we get go back to the cop?
Yeah, basically the cop is over at the waxwork, and he
gets the old closer look bit.
Yeah, with what exhibit was
and
it?
And he ends up with it's the Egyptian exhibit.
Oh yeah, which is a totally cool scene. I mean,
it's the old mummy.
Yeah,
scene.
He said he was always interested in
the ancient Egyptian mm-hmm. stuff, right?
And he gets pushed in.
He gets pushed in, and so he's in there, and it's the, you know, a whole scene where there's an archaeologist there, and mm-hmm. the archaeologist's daughter, I assume, who's pretty cute.
So, just that, like, the scenes alone are amazing to watch this movie for, yeah. You know what I mean? Like, you should really check it out.
Like, if you like anthology horror, because I love anthology horror, which is where you get 3 or 4 stories in one movie.
Yeah.
Well, here you're getting all these little scenes mm-hmm. acted out. Like the werewolf scene I talked about earlier. I mean, you always say that werewolf looks a little funny to you because he's got funny
ears. He's got like these weird like little...
I love that werewolf scene.
You
watch that scene like in the dark when you're alone. It's a creepy scene.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a pretty cool looking werewolf. I love that scene. But yeah, in this Egyptian scene, of course, it's mummies coming to life. And you know, the cop gets killed mm-hmm. along with the other non-monster characters in the scene.
Right.
And it's a pretty cool scene.
It's beautiful, beautifully themed.
It's really well done. Yeah. They have that, is it Swan Lake?
They have Swan Lake.
The music playing, which is like the old silent movies.
Yeah, exactly like the old 30s films and silent films, I mean.
Yeah, and so back to Mark, who is...
over at Sir Wilfred's with Sarah. Mm-hmm. And Sir Wilfred is explaining...
They go see Sir Wilfred, his grandfather's friend, who mm-hmm. Is a wheelchair-bound older man who he was sort of a partner with the grandfather.
With him. They were going around collecting all these artifacts. They were always talking about the occult. It seemed like best friends.
And basically explains everything that David Warner is trying to do.
Yeah, he's like plot exposition completely.
David Warner has never aged since back then because he made a deal with the devil. Mm-hmm. And the deal is he's got these wax figures. And it's a voodoo kind of a thing because mm-hmm. they say it's like voodoo. It's the voodoo end of the world that he's trying to bring about. Which he's got these wax figures. And, you know, you basically make a sacrifice to each of them. And there's a certain number. I don't mm-hmm. remember exactly what the number is. But he's got to get this certain number done by a certain date, which is like that night
or
something.
You know what I just realized? They were talking about the artifacts earlier, about how they stole like 12 artifacts.
Yeah.
Where did those come in? I don't remember.
The artifacts are, they don't really say here, there's the artifact.
Are they stuck in the scene or something?
Yeah, they use the artifact to bring the scene to life. In other words, that's why the scenes are magical.
So why didn't they just steal all the artifacts instead of trying to burn down the place?
You mean to take them out and so they won't work?
Yeah, just take back all the
artifacts. Well, I guess who knows which one is... I don't know. It would take more research. You'd have to know which thing in the scene is the artifact.
That's true. This was an urgent thing.
You know, you could probably find it, but they need to go stop it like by that night or something.
Yeah, good point.
I guess the glasses that guy wanted to steal were probably the artifact.
That was probably an artifact. Oh, and the mask!
The Phantom of the Opera's mask, yeah. So they kind of said, okay, that's...
We're just connecting this now.
Basically, these artifacts, we've seen this movie like hundreds of times for like years, and we still like...
It's because you start to glaze over stuff.
You've seen it so many times, it starts to be something you put on in the background.
Yeah, exactly.
But, so David Warner's character has taken a piece from these actual living people, like say the real mm-hmm. vampire. These are supposed to be people who actually lived in history, and he's got something that character owned,
right?
And he puts it in the scene, and that makes the scene magical.
Yes.
So that you can end up trapped in there, and
I'm sure
somebody
there's some
can
voodoo
die.
Words that he says with it.
When every scene has a victim,
mm-hmm. then they
a real world victim,
come to life.
Then they all come to life and bring the end of the world by just
havoc on the world,
wreaking havoc on the world. So that's what's going to happen on this night.
Yes,
if they're not stopped, you know, before they all come to life, or at least before they. At first, he says before they all come to life, and then it's like sort of like, well, don't let them leave the house.
Exactly. So Sir Wilfred basically tells Sarah and Mark, you need to go burn this place down, you know? So they go and they take their matches and their gasoline, and they go down there, and, Sir Wilfred says good luck before they leave, and they're all down there at the waxwork, and Mark sneaks in, and Sarah's in there with him, and he tries to start to light up a match and start lighting these suckers up, you know, and but he notices that Sarah cannot stop looking at this one exhibit. Freaking Marquis de Sade. And he's like, come on, what are you doing? You know, and he's lighting these things. And she is just mesmerized, and she walks into it, right?
She goes into it.
And of course, that's where we see her scene of where she's totally into the Marquis de Sade and all.
Well, when
stuff.
She goes into it, I think Mark sees... Oh. And then he gets pushed in.
Yes, he gets pushed in by the tall guy.
Okay.
The tall butler.
Into the scene of...
The zombie scene. Which is really cool because it turns all black and white. And I just love it. I think it's fantastic. But he gets out of there really quickly because he realizes this is not real. Apparently, once you instantly realize this is not real and...
Then they can't hurt you.
Then they can't hurt you. So he
It's
found,
just like if they swing it. Let's say they swing a sword at you. It'll go right through you.
Right.
It's like you're not there.
Meanwhile, Sarah's over in this Marquis de Sade thing and she's the virgin in the palace... And
the prince is a guest.
Right.
The prince is played by the director of the film.
The director, yes.
And so he's a special guest, so they're doing a little exhibition
for
the prince where basically they've got a girl chained up and they're like whipping girls and
stuff. They're whipping girls, yeah. And,
and the girls are into it. They're totally into it.
Yeah, I mean...
Yeah, it's their thing, you know.
And so, as does Sarah, as we find out. And she gets all wrapped up in it, and she's... they're putting her on display because she's the virgin of the palace or whatever. And so they chain her up, and they start whipping her. And
she's into it like
she's
crazy.
She's taking it like a champ.
she looks good doing it.
Yeah, and she's loving it, and she's taking it more than anybody ever has, apparently.
but then they decide, the prince decides he wants to see her take it all the way to death, you know?
Because
the guy's like, if I keep beating her, she's going to die. And the prince is like, well, then
we'll move on
to somebody
else.
Then
we'll pleasure one of your other sluts.
Yeah. So you know, they decide to keep going, but that's when Mark comes in.
So Mark gets out of his scene, and as he's rushing over to Sarah's scene, the two butlers are running after him, but he gets into Sarah's scene before they're able to get to him. So he gets in there, and then he fights somebody at the entrance, of course, and then he arrives at the room where Sarah is being whipped, and he's just totally disgusted in her. Like, he's really...
Yeah, I will say this. Like, I know people, I have friends who are in the fetish BDSM community.
I mean, whatever.
This film does kind of make it seem like they kind of frowned upon. Like, this was the 80s, and I guess that was still kind of like, ugh.
Like,
but now it's 50 Shades of Grey, and it's just...
Weird.
Yeah, he's like... What's wrong with you, Sarah? You disgust me. This isn't you and all that.
Yeah.
Which it really kind of was. She's just into it, man.
Yeah, exactly.
But at the same time, she was going to let it go too far.
Yeah, she's going to let herself die.
And so, he talk her out of it? I don't remember.
he starts fighting with the Marquis de Sade.
Well, yeah.
And, but before all this, Sarah throws herself at the feet of the Marquis de Sade. Because
she doesn't want to leave.
She's like rubbing on his leg. I mean, she's like, do not let me leave. And so Mark is like, this isn't you. And then he shows her that it's not real by having the Marquis de Sade shoot him.
Yeah.
And
the bullet passes right through him.
And he's like, look, it's not real if you don't believe it. And then she kind of is like, oh. Shit. You know, like,
I was like, oh, okay.
Like,
she,
oh,
she snaps out of it.
Yeah,
you know?
She does. And then,
so they leave.
Yeah, I don't.
Yeah, there's nothing anybody can do to stop them, so they just leave the scene.
I guess everybody else is kind of freaked out because it's kind of like magic at that time or whatever they're seeing.
Yeah,
stuff.
Well, he's like, look, you can't hurt us. So they just walk out of the scene.
But the Marquis de Sade says, I will see you again.
Yeah.
I'll be seeing you later or something like that.
So when they stumble out of the scene, mm-hmm. they're grabbed immediately by the two, we keep calling them butlers, but because they look like butlers, but they're the people who work at the waxwork.
Going back though, we can't discount the moment that Sarah and Mark had when Sarah's on the ground.
Oh, yeah, they do one of those.
And she reaches
out
for his hand, and then Mark is like, he has this moment of hesitation, but then he finally grabs her hand, and it's like the music swells, and it's just like this moment.
So this
it's
is like
okay,
them
so
two becoming
they
love, in love.
Yeah, they're in love or okay. whatever.
So although he doesn't understand her fetishes, so it's not gonna work. But anyway, so they go back into the waxwork out of the scene, yeah. and they're grabbed immediately by the giant and the dwarf.
Right.
And
actually, David Warner is there with them.
Yeah,
as well.
He's there too. And, he's probably the other one that grabbed mm-hmm. him, because I don't think the dwarf grabbed him.
Oh yeah, good point. And they
pull them over to the side,
right?
Because they know
that
James
and
Gemma are coming in,
right?
Because they're still trying to find mm-hmm. out where all the things are.
They were probably told by David Warner that they were there or something. Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't see that.
I don't remember if they went to anyone to find out where to go, but they went to the wax work looking for the friends again, I guess.
Right, and I mean, instantly. I mean, these. Like pathetic. Like they're instantly taken into these worlds.
Well, I mean that's like, I think that's just the way it looks from the outside. When somebody goes into one of the scenes,
it takes forever.
They instantly
maybe they fought them
from all. Like the perspective of being of looking at the scene.
Yeah, it happens instantly.
You instantly see the person dead there.
Right.
As one of the waxwork people.
But when you're in the scene, it's taking
it can take as long as it has to take.
Days or something. Anyway, basically,
James goes into the zombie scene and he's becomes the victim.
Because
there.
He's so into the glasses that the zombie's wearing, he's like, "Nutty zombies from hell," or something like that.
Those are the glasses from Nutty Zombies.
Yeah,
from hell.
He's like, "I gotta have those for my collection." Yeah. So he decides to go and steal them. I mean, that's,
yeah.
Okay.
A weird thing about that is he's recognized these glasses as glasses from a zombie movie. And yet, they're supposed to be artifacts from historical situations. There's a few little things like
that.
They don't really bother you when you're watching the movie.
Because it's so quirky.
Yeah, it's just a fun, quirky movie.
You gotta know that you gotta lose yourself in this movie and just, it's a
movie. And, so anyway, he becomes the victim for the zombie scene.
And dear Gemma gets stuck with the Marquis de
Sade. So, everything is...
So instantly,
activated.
Like all this blue electricity starts happening, and everybody starts coming to life. All these creatures, and even the victims. The victims apparently, once they have been attacked and killed by these monsters, they have turned into monsters themselves.
They're just mean. They're evil. Everything that comes alive
is evil and trying to kill.
They
explain that
they're possessed,
they're possessed by the evil.
And so, yeah, they all come alive, and they want to get out and, you know, attack the world, but...
And then all of a sudden, there's
the
a
doors
burst
through
the
open,
door, and Sir Wilfred is there
rolls
in his wheelchair with his sword.
And so is Mark's butler and a bunch of old guys mm-hmm. who are just, you know, these, like, longtime fighters of evil.
Right.
And so they come in, and they're like, let's, you know, kill...
Yeah, let's kill
don't let a
let's
single
storm
one
the
leave.
Castle and kill everybody.
Don't let a single one leave. So they're like... You know, so they start fighting. They
so
start
this,
fighting all the monsters.
This major fight scene starts happening. And, I mean, you got such funny moments. Like, this bat starts coming towards this one guy. And he grabs him. And with the gun, he says, "Make my day."
It's all this, like, it's this goofy
it's just
fight
totally
scene.
Goofy.
I mean, but it's like, it doesn't lose its, like... You know,
no,
tension.
It's still
climactic
right movie,
and,
yeah.
like, yeah. But there's jokes in it.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
I love when Sarah feeds the dwarf
to the plant from Little Shop of Horrors. Yeah.
And I mean,
You basically see more characters than you had before, all in this big fight. If you've ever seen the movie Cabin in the Woods, which is one of my favorite more recent horror films, that scene in the end where all the monsters are just running, wreaking havoc throughout the whole laptop or whatever it is.
It's very much like that.
Yeah, it's got to have been inspired by Waxwork, by this climactic scene in Waxwork. So anyway, that you know.
And they're seeing their old friends, and their old friends are trying to attack them. Tony and Chyna and Gemma and James, yeah. And they're all possessed by this evil, and they're trying to attack
him. And they still recognize him, and they address him by their names and everything. But they're
Mark almost gets it by Chyna.
Yeah, Chyna's like, you know, trying to seduce him, but she's a vampire now. Yeah. And.
But anyway, people end up dying. The butler ends up dying.
Sir Wilfred ends up dying.
Yeah, he ends up dying. Oh, later
There's like a big sword fight scene, is there?
There's a sword fight scene.
The thing is, you can kind of get some of this stuff confused with the sequel, but they start sword fighting.
The Marquis, right? De Sade sees him from far off in the room, and he's like, "I'm gonna get you," and he goes and follows Mark, or does Mark follow him? I don't know. Anyway, one of them follows each other into. Oh, Mark goes into the wax room. Where they make the actual figures. So there's a big tub, there's a big vat, a huge thing of wax. And so he's in there, and... oh, by the way, sorry. Sir Wilfred had given Mark his grandfather's sword. And so, I mean, that's like a really important thing.
Plus, it's made out of silver, so he can kill werewolves.
Exactly. So I think he actually killed Tony earlier on, which is really sad, because he was a werewolf. But anyway, he went into the wax room, and the Marquis de Sade follows him. Oh, okay. Mark had gone into the wax room because he was following...
It was David Warner?
David Warner, yeah.
So I believe his character's name is Mr. Lincoln.
Yeah, David...
David Warner.
I don't know. David Warner, Mark, and the Marquis de Sade are all in this room together. And the Marquis de Sade and Mark start sword fighting. So they start fighting each other, and I mean, Mark is horrible. And the Marquis de Sade is like, you know, he's taking the sword away from him, and then he's like throwing it back to him. He wants to like have a good fight or whatever. Anyways, so this sword fight happens, and Mark is about to get it because the Marquis de Sade has him cornered, and he's about to stab him. And David Warner gives him a little thumbs down, and he's like, "Kill the wimp."
Yeah. But then Marquis de Sade gets a knife in the back from Sarah.
Yes, Sarah.
And Sarah does some fighting here, and which is kind of funny when the sequel comes out.
Yeah, okay. So
we'll talk about that then. But
Sarah has been this innocent character this whole time, and we finally see her come into her own. She's fighting these things, and she kills the Marquis de Sade, and she's all badass. They show this shot of her, and she's like, "That's right, I killed you." so it's just when you see the sequel, it's a little annoying.
Yeah, we'll get into the sequel in a minute, but yeah. So so basically, you know, they kill all the bad guys get killed.
Yeah.
They set the place on fire.
Well, who pushes David Warner into the vat?
Who pushed David Warner in the vat? Well, somebody pushes David Warner.
I think it was Sir Wilfred.
It was probably Sir Wilfred.
Sir Wilfred came in.
Yeah.
And then after he did that, then the werewolf comes in and like totally kills Sir Wilfred. And it's really sad.
Yeah.
Anyway, this big mess of stuff. The only two people that come out of it basically are Mark and Sarah. They just kind of flee when they know that
and
the place
one
is going
other
out.
Escapee is
oh, yes.
a severed hand.
A severed hand
from
crawling around.
Is it from the zombie scene? Which scene? I think it's from the zombie scene, right? Severed hand.
Did they
ever show where the severed hand?
I'm
came
sure
from?
If we looked back at it, we would see a part where.
There's
somebody,
a lot to look at in this movie.
I'm
yeah.
sure we could see a part where somebody cuts off a hand and.
Yeah,
and
I don't remember.
Crawling
but
around. I don't remember.
There's
either.
A severed hand that escapes the whole. You know, fire. There's a whole waxwork burns down, and Sarah and Mark escape, and that hand.
Right.
And that's the end, basically.
Mm-hmm. That's the end.
And cut to. Was it? That's my party.
My
party.
Yeah.
That's my party.
That's
my party.
Yeah. That's your party. But anyway,
I'm not a big fan of 60s girl groups.
Oh God, I love 60s girl groups. I love 60s anything.
So anyway, that's the credits song, kind of reminiscent of American Werewolf in London.
Yeah, lots of good music in this. What's funny is that some of the music, though, is like a hybrid between the 80s and the 50s, and it's like kind of this quirky, like weird soundtrack music. But
being, you know, having been a little kid in the 80s, they had a thing for the 50s.
No, I know.
There was a whole thing about the 50s and the 80s. They, you know, you had Happy Days and you had like...
Well, there's this diner in
all these, like, revival malt shops and diners. And
was made in the 80s, but it was all
50s. Yeah.
So, anyway, yeah, the first movie, fantastic.
Excellent movie.
You guys should really see it.
Yeah, it's goofy at times on, I want to say on purpose, you know?
Yeah.
It's a horror comedy, it is. Now, this one is a little bit more horror.
Yeah.
Then the sequel.
The next one is more sci-fi.
The sequel's a little more sci-fi horror comedy.
But yeah, the first one is two thumbs up. Fine holiday fun. I said that.
Yeah. And I know where that's from.
I know.
But yeah, it's a great movie. We watch it all the time, even though it's hard to remember some of the details, but. And part of that is because the sequel does, you know, similar things.
Yeah.
Even the big sword fight and everything. But yeah, Halloween, we always watch it, you know, at least once in October.
We watch it when it's
but
not
we
Halloween.
Watch it all throughout the year. We watch Waxwork.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes, we will watch Waxwork 2.
Yes.
Right after. Do a double feature because it's right there, so it's easy.
Would you say that you like Waxwork 2 as much as Waxwork 1?
Not as much, no.
Okay.
Not even by far. And I do like Waxwork 2.
Cool.
And maybe the more I watch it, because I've watched the first one way more,
mm-hmm.
maybe the more I watch it, the more... I think I do like it more every time I watch it.
Do you know what these two movies kind of... I mean, similarities in the way they were structured and it kind of reminds me of Mannequin 1 and Mannequin 2. You know what I mean? In the fact that I like them both a lot, but I'm more attached to one.
Does Mannequin 2 have the same? And I have to say, like, I love Mannequin 1. I haven't really sat and watched Mannequin 2.
Okay, when I was a little girl, Mannequin 2 came out later, obviously. So that's the one that I saw the most when I was a little girl. And so I was attached to that one the most as a child. But as a teenager, I saw Mannequin 1, and that's my favorite one now. Mannequin 2 is kind of a lot more quirky and stuff. I went back and watched Mannequin 2 again, and I was like, wow, this is way, it's in the same arena as the first one, but it's also much more quirky and outlandish.
But it's probably not the same director.
I'm not sure about that.
This one, you've got the same writer and director.
Yeah.
He is the writer and the director on both films. And yet, there are some interesting changes when they get to the second film.
So you want to just dive right into it?
Well, let's see. Is there anything else we need to say about the first film? I mean, we love the first film so much. I mean, what can you say?
I can't say anything bad about it because
I
love it so much.
But there is nothing bad to say. Unless you don't like the quirkiness or, like, you were saying it had a kind of the Twin Peaks thing, which is because of the way they sort of mix in the film noir.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And the whole 50s film noir thing, which it does. And that kind of adds to the quirkiness. And there's a lot of, you know, there's humor in it.
Oh,
they amp that up in the second one. But it's a little bit more cheesy when they do it in the second one. There's nothing bad to say about the first film.
No.
We love the first film.
And I'm sure some of you out there will be like, well, there's tons of loopholes, or I don't know. we love it so much that we don't see those anymore. Even if we saw them the first time, I don't remember seeing them.
They don't bother us. I mean, we might see them, but they don't bother us. You know, there's going to be people who don't like it. But for us, Waxwork is one of those go-to movies.
Classics.
We're always in the mood to watch Waxwork.
Yes.
Always.
Yes.
And... the second one, which like you say, we like it a lot.
I really like it. But let's start off.
Let's start off
with the characters. You want to? I just want to mention.
Well, let's say it picks up right after.
Yes.
Like right when that scene, the final scene of the first movie, it picks up right from there, which always seems like a great thing for a sequel.
Are some notable changes that you will see. First off, Sarah is not played by the same actress.
That is the biggest issue with the film.
And I haven't seen this actress in other stuff, and it's not that she's a bad actress, it's just that I didn't like her as Sarah. She played it too innocently. After Sarah had gone through all this stuff and had become this badass at the end, all of a sudden she's this innocent broken down girl again.
She was more ditzy.
Yeah, and she was kind of ditzy
than innocent.
As well.
And I mean, she was innocent, but And also, the big thing is, you know, the other one was cute little short Sarah who looks like she's from the 50s, really.
Oh, they went with a totally different look for her.
This one is like 80s model type type looking girl, you know? Or, you know, 80s, you know, music video queen girl.
She barely dresses 50s anymore. And also, when they take her, I mean, as far as her status in the world,
She's slumming it
with her father, who is like beating her.
His stepfather. She lives with her stepfather. Actually, I don't know if she's being abused by his stepfather, because he does.
Well, very nearly.
He like does this thing where he's gonna smack her, and then he looks at his hand, and he's like,
he's probably hit her before.
I don't have any idea, because
anyway,
they implied like he was like, maybe he only did it once before, maybe he's never done it. I don't know.
But
he was about to.
It's kind of frustrating to me because of the character development in the first one.
It was
one.
It was like a different character.
And I grew to love Mark and Sarah from the first film, and I wanted to see them together in the second film. And yeah, it was just those actors were so much better in the first one, I feel like.
They had chemistry.
They had better chemistry, yeah.
Yeah, they don't really.
I mean, a little bit of chemistry in the.
I think I have more problem with the second Sarah.
I think
Sarah
you
than
do
you
too.
Do.
There was also something else that I was going to say that was way different. But
the funny thing is, the apartment complex
it
looks the same. It's the same
it's
on the
same
outside
exterior, but when
so
you go on
the
inside,
to be consistent.
It's like horrible.
Yeah, the apartment. And I mean, you know, that could have been the
and
case
before.
And
she didn't come across as this girl who was having a hard time in the first one at all. She just seemed kind of repressed, you know? Very repressed.
Like a goody two-shoes kind of person.
Yeah. I mean, she was wearing these, like, I even noticed in the first one she was wearing these sapphire, like, earrings. I mean, totally not. You couldn't get
not
that.
Poor.
Yeah, you couldn't get that as anyway, so let's start off.
Well, yeah, because the movie starts. Does it start off with the trial? Well, I mean, at first they show the hand escaping.
Yeah. No,
but then
they show the hand escaping, and they show Mark and Sarah taking a taxi ride over to her apartment, and he drops her off.
They take a lot of taxi rides in this.
And he's like telling her, "Don't worry, it'll be okay," and all this stuff. And so Sarah ends up going up to her apartment room, and somehow the hand followed her.
Yeah, that little hand.
I don't remember
it probably. I don't remember if it grabbed onto the taxi cab, but it went home with
them.
In the taxi. I don't remember. And
it followed her into the apartment and ended up murdering the
her
father.
Stepfather.
Her stepfather.
It's just like, you know, that old bit.
Yeah. And so. This whole beginning, I mean, this introduces the fact that now Sarah is being...
She's now on trial for the murder of her father,
mm-hmm.
a stepfather.
Stepfather.
And they're also, in the trial, they're also talking about the waxwork that burned down and all
I mean, they're trying to connect
the hundreds
together.
Of people
yeah.
died, which
exactly.
I guess we're all the wax monster and stuff.
They're saying how suspicious
and
it was
the,
and all
old
stuff.
Men.
And,
Yeah,
but
they're
yeah,
trying
so
to get her
in,
for the murder of the stepfather,
she's in trial.
And she has said in
she
the trial
has no evidence
that because she saw the hand
she
and she killed the hand.
She said that the hand did it.
She said a severed hand did it.
Yeah.
And the problem with that is she stuffed that severed hand down the garbage disposal,
yes.
or it jumped down there, and she turned
she
on
tried
the garbage
to save
disposal.
It, save him
so,
or something.
No evidence as
no
far
evidence
as
whatsoever.
The severed hand.
So everybody just thinks she's nuts. And Mark is in the courtroom with her, and he makes it worse. He stands up and starts saying, "Sarah didn't do it," and all this stuff, you know, the classic boyfriend thing.
Yeah.
And so he gets taken out by security, and she gets escorted out. I guess they say they're gonna decide later on or something.
Yeah, it's one of the trials to be continued.
Right. so he and Sarah are out of the courtroom now, and they go to Sir Wilfred's house, and they're trying to find some sort of evidence to help her, to back her up that this fiasco happened. And
they find a film or something. There's some kind of film reel.
They said that they checked every room in the house, and they walked into this one room. They were like, this is the only room we haven't checked. And all you see when you open the door to the room is a table with a chessboard.
Okay, so they find the film reel when they go in there.
And then there's also a film reel with a projection screen. And
but they have this, they get a clue about an Alice in Wonderland.
Not yet. It's in the actual film that he gives her the clue.
That's why I thought they saw the film first before
but they did see the film first, but the actual chessboard is there.
Okay, so yeah. I don't remember when they see the film. Is it just when they walked in the room?
Walked in the room and she turns it on.
Okay, she turns on this film and it's set up, and the film is Sir Wilfred saying, if you're watching this, I'm dead.
That whole Scream, what is it, Scream 2 or Scream
3? Before that
came
out. I'm pretty sure.
With Randy.
Actually, the first movie came out in 1988. The second one came out in 1992. I have no idea when Scream. Huh?
Does it say there?
I already know that. Yeah, I've looked it up. I researched.
No.
Because I always thought the first one was an older movie than that, but yeah, apparently 88.
Oh.
The second one, 1992, and I don't know if we mentioned, Zach Galligan is back. It's the same,
yes,
same
it is
Mark.
Zach, which is awesome.
It's just different Sarah. Mm-hmm. And same Sir Wilfred, except he's just on a film. And he explains to them about that little device.
He says, if you're seeing me, then I'm dead or whatever on here. And he talks to him, he tells him, oh no, he says something about like there's evidence that you can find. I don't think he even mentions the device.
Okay.
But he's just talking to them.
He says to follow Alice through the looking glass.
Yeah, he says follow Alice through the looking glass. And Mark's like, what the hell are you talking about?
So they look, and then this room has a chess table, and they're Alice in Wonderland characters on the chess.
And Sarah has apparently read Alice in Wonderland a lot. And,
she picks up the Alice, and it opens a secret passage.
Yeah, exactly. Way.
So they go into the secret passageway, and they find all those old artifacts.
Yeah,
and things.
Yeah. Hey,
this guy's got like the Ark of the Covenant.
I
in
know.
There. He's got what else?
Jason's mask.
Jason Voorhees mask. He's got
like
all this
stuff.
It's funny because they reference, you know, in both of these movies, they reference like other movies.
Mm-hmm.
Carefully, because of course you know they can't actually use
the
movies.
There's other stuff too. I can't remember.
But
it was
obviously
really
Jason Voorhees mask, and just things like that in this room. And at some point he finds this device.
Yes.
Which opens a portal
to another world.
It's like. As far as they know, they think they're traveling through time when they
go to this portal. Yeah, they think they're doing a similar thing to what they were doing in the Waxworks.
Like they're going to be able to go back in time and get evidence.
Right.
Like a severed hand or something.
Yeah. So they open one of the doors with this compass. It's kind of like a compass type thing, and it basically he'll point it at any point in the room, and it'll
find the doorway.
It'll find the doorway to
sliders.
The
totally,
yeah,
the totally TV show sliders.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. So they open the doorway, and where do they go first?
The first place to go is Frankenstein's
place. And Sarah is nowhere to be found. He cannot find her anywhere.
Because when they went through the portal, they're like, falling through this, like, darkness.
A very Alice in Wonderland scene when she's
that's
falling.
True. And these, like, bat creature monsters are trying to grab them.
Yeah, and they grab them and separate them.
But
and one of them takes Sarah off and...
I don't think they manage to, like, hold on to them, but they do manage to separate them. And so they go to two different places and we don't know where. So Mark ends up in this in the scenario of Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm.
And he's, like, Frankenstein's friend, the doctor's friend.
Right.
And they're in Frankenstein's house and he tells him to go feed the... feed the monster. So he goes and he goes to feed Frankenstein's monster. And he looks in the barrel of food, and there's just, like, maggots all over it.
And he's like, I can't feed you this.
and he sees a plate of food over there that obviously
Dr.
Frankenstein was going to eat. So he gives that to the monster. He's looking around. He gets out of there, and he finds Sarah.
He does. Well, he gets out of there, and he sees Sarah, and she's the wife of Dr. Frankenstein.
Or the fiance or wife.
Uh-huh.
And she is mentally, like, She's got some kind of brain damage from from this.
Well, it's because once again she shows how weak she is in the fact that she cannot separate herself from these worlds that she's traveling.
She thinks
in.
She is the person.
I mean, when Mark went through, instantly was Mark again, and when Sarah went through, she was Victor Frankenstein's fiance or wife or whatever.
At some point, he explains like it's like, oh, this time travel is messing with your head, like
Swiss cheese
in her brain, like. Sam, finally.
Yes.
So she's like starting to think she's these characters that whenever she goes into them, and which she's adapting better, but she's you know she doesn't know who Mark is or anything.
Once,
it really is.
Once she sees Mark, Mark sees her from far away in the house, and then he sees where her bedchambers are, and he rushes to her bedchambers, and she sees him, and then he kind of has to. Coax her and be like, hey, you know, you are Sarah. Mm-hmm. And she finally snaps out of it for a second. So they try to escape the room, and Victor Frankenstein
catches them
and immediately thinks that they're having an affair with each other. But Sarah's snapping in and out of her mental state because he was accusing her of being in the affair with his friend. And she was like, well, maybe if you weren't spending all your time with that monster, then I wouldn't. So, yeah, her mental state is going back and forth.
She's very confused on who she is. Oh, and an important thing, whenever they go to they're in this world and they're trying to find anything they can to help Sarah in her trial. By having some kind of severed hand that's
alive.
Mark
is grasping at anything he can try and
Mark
get.
Is trying to get Frankenstein's notebook so they can use it to bring the dead back to life.
Right.
So they can prove that.
Or to prove that it's possible to bring the dead back to life.
Somehow
to
get her off of the murder trial.
Right.
So anyway, that's basically their mission on all this time travel stuff is to bring something back.
Yes.
To help her in her trial to prove that everything they've been saying is true. All this magic stuff. And so he's trying to grab the notebook, Frankenstein's notebook, and then this there's this big chase scene because Frankenstein's trying to kill him.
Yeah, exactly.
The monster ends up grabbing Frankenstein while Frankenstein is trying to get the monster to attack Mark, but he won't. You know, the monster remembers that he gave him some food, some real food.
Yeah, so that's he's
so
like, oh,
he
kind of
lets him go.
Mm-hmm.
A crowd of
a mob from the village.
Yeah, the angry village mob with the pitchforks.
They come breaking down,
have busted in, and they're trying to get Frankenstein.
So it's like this crazy scene.
Yeah.
And basically, Mark ends up opening the portal with his compass, and sends Sarah through. And then, he's still trying to grab because they're running around in the room. It's like this
around the table chase. Trying to get the book and not get killed.
And it's very comedic. I mean, this whole movie is so much more old school comedy.
But it's still a sci-fi adventure, action horror.
We said it's more like Sam Raimi. It was calling.
Yeah, and that's what it is.
Yeah.
It's very, very much like the old Evil Dead stuff.
Right.
Army of Darkness.
Yeah.
If you're into that stuff, Waxwork 2,
it's really funny.
It was, and I think I was picking up on that the more times I, when we watched it just this
very
time.
Very much like Army of Darkness.
Because I'm a huge Evil Dead and Army of Darkness
fan.
We're both huge fans.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of that. I was actually looking at the directors. Is this, is Sam Raimi?
Is Sam Raimi? Are they friends?
Because there was definitely, they might have been, because later, Bruce Campbell appears in this movie later.
Yes, he does.
Yeah, which happens pretty quick here. So Mark goes through the tunnel separate from her.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember if he got Frankenstein's book. Did he?
I feel like it was knocked away, but anyway, it doesn't matter. Because
he doesn't hang on to
it.
Even if he brought it through, he loses it at some point. But they end up in separate places.
And Sarah ends up in one of my favorite movies, Aliens.
She's in a fake version of Aliens.
Yeah. So basically these time portals or wherever they're ending up, they're very similar to movies.
You get the impression at the early on that they're traveling through time, but clearly they're traveling through movies. Or movies and books, but it's not really history.
So she's basically Sigourney Weaver in Aliens.
Yeah. While he has
Flash
gone...
Alien because
He's gotten into one of those black and white realms where he's in the movie, what, The Haunting?
The Haunting, yeah. The old
original black and white version.
Yes, which is, let's not get into it, but it's so much better than the remake. But yeah. Anyway.
We do have to do a review on those two movies sometime.
Yeah, we do. So, I mean, just by what we've said already about this movie, I actually really like this film because of all of the different scenes that they take you in, especially because they are movies and they are some of the movies that I love. Very interesting stuff.
Yeah, well, with me, like when we watched Waxwork 1, mm-hmm. we almost always let Waxwork 2 play after.
Yeah, exactly.
But a lot of times I don't stick around and watch Waxwork mm-hmm. 2 just because
I have
other stuff to do. I don't know. but I do, when I do sit and watch it, which I have done many times, mm-hmm. I really do enjoy it, but like, I'll forget sometimes because I leave a bigger gap in between.
It's very enjoyable.
In between watching it, I leave a bigger gap and I forget about the parts that I really liked in part two.
It really is enjoyable and there are some really solid actors. I mean,
But it's goofier.
It's really fun.
It's goofier. It's and very I goofy. Like goofy stuff.
Yeah.
But like, I guess when I like watch Waxwork 1, I kind of want to watch like a very similar, more similar.
I can see that.
And there's similarities, no doubt,
totally.
Between the two, but you know. I don't know, I want more of
the
50s.
The 50s kind of feel is thrown out the window from the first one.
And the horror is much more toned down.
It's
much cheesier. More of a sci-fi thing. That's the thing. And I like sci-fi, but like if I've just watched the first Waxwork, I was watching a horror comedy. Mm-hmm. And after that, I want to watch another horror comedy.
See, and I am a sci-fi nerd. I love sci-fi so much. So anytime I can get sci-fi, I will watch it.
And I love sci-fi, but unless it's Star Wars, I tend to like horror more.
Okay.
Star Wars is like my second favorite thing after Disney.
Yeah. But I love sci-fi more than horror. I love horror too, but sci-fi is.
Even though I'm squeamish about gore, I love horror movies.
Yeah.
But I love especially monster stuff more so than killers or
slashers.
Like whether they're supernatural slashers like Jason or just like Scream, like real I do like Scream movies, but mm-hmm. you know, just like.
Oh, you're much more of a classic monster.
I like werewolves and vampires and things like that. And I do. I mean, I'll enjoy a slasher horror film, but I do prefer the monster stuff.
We usually like the horror films that other horror addicts don't like. Well, so I don't know.
I just like a lot of movies other people don't like, but I also like really popular stuff.
Like, I mean, most people they probably won't like Waxworks 2.
Most people might find the second film too cheesy. I think most horror fans give the first one a chance will like it. Oh, I mean, I think most horror fans love it, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's, you know, the second one is a little cheesier, but it's more sci-fi. Mm-hmm. It's more sci-fi, that's all.
Yeah.
And it's got more campy humor. Because it is, you know, the humor in both these films is more of a campy kind of humor, but especially in the second one.
That's true.
Yeah, there's way more in the second
one. So anyway, getting back, so Sarah's over in the alien scene, and Mark is over
in the haunting.
So let's just touch on what Mark's doing. So he's the young guy in
It's all black and white. Haunting.
Yeah, it's all black and white.
He's like the assistant, he's one of the guys. Yeah.
And his first, I think the first thing he sees is the haunted house, and he turns around and like, who's coming up the walkway? But Bruce Campbell.
Bruce Campbell.
And he's like
greatest actor of our time.
Oh, I love him.
I have a handful of greatest actors of our time.
Yes.
Bruce Campbell, David Warner, Harrison Ford.
Yeah, all of them.
A bunch. But yeah, Bruce Campbell. And he's like the researcher who's brought this group of people together into this haunted
house. The one who's investigating the paranormal. And
kind of investigating the people who are investigating. If you've seen The Haunted, The Haunting.
Which I haven't seen the original in a long time, so I don't remember exactly what happened, but I remember the remake so vividly that I remember it being pretty similar except for the horrible
it's
stuff.
Similar, it's
but
just
totally different at the same time.
My problem with that one was all the CGI.
Hate CGI.
I don't hate CGI in other stuff, but I don't like it in horror.
Oh, I know.
Because it's like if I'm watching a fantasy film and there's a CGI creature, mm-hmm. okay, but if I'm watching a horror film, for me to like get invested in the scariness.
Right.
If I know the thing's not really there, I can't really, you know.
Yeah. Totally.
Sometimes I can force myself to really lose myself in the scene, mm-hmm. So that I can, but it's way more work than if you have practical effects.
Yeah, I agree.
But anyway, these movies have practical effects.
He's in the haunting scene, and they're basically having all these little moments from the haunting happen. He's going around the house and trying to find Sarah because he thinks that Sarah's going to be there, but she's not. And I guess he's trying to also find evidence or something that he can take back with him.
Well, he's always trying to find some kind of proof that will show all this, like, supernatural stuff they've been dealing with, but especially anything that's, like, proof of, like, how, you know, of, like, a living dead type thing.
And there are a lot of great moments. I mean, this scene is genuinely creepy. They have a shot of, and I mean,
before it gets all Bruce Campbell crazy campy.
Yeah. I mean, they have a shot that's like straight out of the original film where the woman is hanging. One of the women, was hanging up on the banister or something. And, I mean, it's creepy and I don't get scared very, very often. But
then they had like the little girl ghost that was like in color.
That was lame. There are lame moments, but
yeah.
And there's a lot of Bruce Campbell quirkiness, especially at the end of that scene.
Yeah, who is he with in that scene? With Bruce Campbell is all like torn open. Oh, that's just a girl that's in the scene.
Which girl?
There's a girl in that scene where there's the climactic part of the Bruce Campbell. A haunting bit
is where
he's got his like ribs exposed.
Mark finds him in the cellar, and Bruce Campbell has got his ribs exposed, and like he's
basically.
And there's
a girl with him in that scene.
Yeah, he's been tortured by this ghost, but it's the girl, the haunting girl. Evelyn, that's from House on Haunted Hill. But yeah, the haunting.
Was that an actress that we know or anything?
I've seen her in other stuff before.
I don't know. I don't remember who how she looked.
So anyway,
but yeah. It's a really campy scene.
Yeah, it's really campy. And basically, Mark ends up saving the day. And so he's like, I kind of like saving the day. This is feeling good. So.
Meanwhile, before he gets out of that scene, though, we've seen some of her in dealing with the aliens.
Yes. Thing, so Sarah, like, over on the other side, is dealing with the alien thing. And she's totally into the role. She doesn't know who she is, really.
And I zone out a little bit during this part.
I don't, because I love Alien.
I love the Alien movies, the real ones, but I can never watch knockoff Alien movies.
I can see that.
Any movies that are just trying to recapture.
Except for Spaceballs.
Well, Spaceballs is a Star Wars parody. Yeah. It's got some funny, yeah, that's a comedy.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
But, one of the funny actors in the Alien scene is, I don't remember his name, but it's the main guy from Grease 2, which, I grew up on that film and I love that film, and, it's just funny to see him in that role. He's kind of playing,
you see some familiar faces in these movies that you're like, oh, I know that, you know,
yeah,
person.
Yeah, exactly.
Was it the lawyer, the girl's lawyer, Sarah's lawyer in this is
Haley Mills' sister. Yeah.
If you know Disney movies, you know Haley Mills.
Mm-hmm.
And her sister is an actress also, yeah.
Seen Nanny and the Professor.
Oh, yeah, from Nanny and the Professor. If you watch old TV shows like 60s
yes, we do.
TV shows.
All the time.
But, yeah, so anyway, so he gets out of his scene.
His scene after having saved the day. And
goes into hers.
Uh-huh.
And he tells her that he's gone through all these other things that we didn't get to see. She asks him where the book is.
Frankenstein journal is, and
he says the Loch Ness monster ate it. Which we never got to see that.
No,
that would have been
really
cool.
So
anyway, so he's there in Alien, and he's dressed like one of the Marines there with her, and they deal with the alien,
and they end up getting out, and she finally snaps out of her mental state when she sees Mark.
Yeah, because
so
she
like,
thinks she's
he's
the
like her leader. Anchor in this almost. So anyway, they get out of that scene and they are transported to a medieval
land.
Times.
Medieval times, and what happens there? He's all Prince Valiant with his hair.
And he says, you're stunning or something like that. Because
she looks very attractive.
She, yeah,
like
medieval,
a medieval,
not maiden.
Like more
medieval
of a,
princess
almost like a princess
yeah,
type.
Yeah, regal. And anyway, so they're talking and they're like, where are we? And immediately this group of,
knights or something, soldiers
horrible
or whatever.
Knights end up coming around and stealing her away. And Mark's
he doesn't, they don't take him away. No. Later he gets thrown in the dungeon.
But he hears this voice in the distance. And he turns around, and who is it?
It's David Carradine.
Yay!
From Kung Fu and a million other things.
Yeah.
Kill Bill and all that. And he's this beggar. Laying by a tree or something. And
so they've stolen your love too, or something like that.
Does he give him the sword?
Yeah, he gives him this sword.
Sword.
For no reason at all, he's just like, here's the sword.
Go get
your maiden or whatever.
And
he's like, okay. And so so he walks off. I mean, it's a very special, touching moment.
Yeah,
and
we'll find out why later.
So
he goes on to go rescue
her. Storm the castle. And
she's...
Meanwhile, we find that she's dealing with a bunch of...
weird people. It's like a cult. It's this medieval setup, right? But this cult is right out of Conan the Destroyer.
Yeah.
It brought to mind two movies, that one and Cat People.
Cat People, weird stuff.
Basically, they were doing all these cult magic ceremonies where they're having women get raped by animals and it turns them into the animal monsters
and
creatures.
But I think he's
I think he's trying to perfect some sort of transformation potion.
Right, exactly. So Sarah is this woman, and she is the sister of
the guy that we're talking about, who's into all this. He's some kind of lord or some kind of royal, not royalty, but.
And he is desperate to become king. So at first we're thinking that he's just going to marry off Sarah, his sister, to the king. So that's what we're all thinking. And she's saying, I don't want to marry the king, because she thinks she is this woman. Once again, she gets wrapped up in the whole story. And there's this really funny side character, he's not the court jester. He's the
little sidekick guy.
He's the cousin in
he's this
in
foppish
Prince
guy.
Of Thieves, but not really.
Yeah, no, he's the sidekick of the main bad guy. And, they're the two main villains that you have to deal with in this scene. And, basically the main villain here, he wants to use this potion to make himself look like the king.
Yes.
And kill off the king and take his place and marry his own sister and be king.
So, and this whole time, Mark is playing the character of her stable boy boyfriend or something like that. And,
he's there to rescue her, and they end up putting him in the dungeon. I don't remember how they,
because they're onto them and they want her to marry the king. So they're trying to keep... They even check her virginity at one point.
Okay, because they catch them talking or whatever, and they're like, "Oh, he's."
I bet they've
Yeah, let's check her and make sure she's still a virgin, and take him to the dungeon.
Yeah.
And so they took him to the dungeon and they check her out, and she's fine. And
and then they decide to invite the king over for a party to introduce the two to introduce Sarah to the king, and it's kind of a messed up party, but it's a party. There's a lot going on.
Yeah, and meanwhile, he's in the dungeon, and this raven shows up.
Yes.
And starts talking to him, and it's Sir Wilfred.
Uh-huh,
he's
from the
a
first
raven.
Movie.
Yeah, and he says, this is the only time I can help you out, and that was the only time your grandfather could help you out, which the grandfather is the beggar that gave him the sword. So anyway, so Sir Wilfred...
explains to him,
helps him escape, and also gives him back. I think he gives him.
He gives him back
the time thing.
Yeah,
because he's lost this time thing.
I don't know. He's really bad with
careless. He's very careless with his time travel device, and he's lost it. And I think the bird gives it back.
And he also explains to him that the beggar was his grandfather, and
they can't help him anymore.
He explains to him. I believe he says that. You've stumbled upon God's Nintendo game.
Yeah. So basically, they haven't been traveling through time.
Right.
They've been traveling through God's Nintendo game, which is God and the devil.
Battling it out until...
Whenever evil wins in one of these scenes, then some disaster happens on Earth.
Yeah, like a hurricane or a
something that just, wreaks havoc.
Or something. So basically, he introduced the term Time Warrior to Mark, and he's trying to break it to Mark that God wants him to be a Time Warrior.
And that it's like this great,
honor.
It's the greatest honor you're going to get is to be chosen to be a Time Warrior.
And Mark is kind of like, okay, I like, helping everybody and these people. He's kind of feeding into it a little bit, but he doesn't have time for this right now. He's trying to save Sarah.
Yeah.
But at the same time,
and his mind is still on getting back and clearing Sarah in this trial, because he doesn't really want to stay and be a Time Warrior.
Right.
They just want to go back, right?
And Sir Wilfred even mentions the fact that he should stay and be a Time Warrior. But Mark is like, but I love Sarah, basically. And so he's got this conflict going on from now on of whether or not he's going to stay. But anyway, so... So he leaves the dungeon and
the raven lets him out.
Mm-hmm,
so
he releases all the other prisoners from the dungeon too, because he's a Time Warrior, or he wants to be one, I think.
He's like, come help me fight. You want to fight? Mm-hmm. So then they go out there to...
And by the way, there's so much comedic things going on.
Yeah, there's a lot of comedy.
It seems
in this
really
one.
Dark, but there's a lot of comedy going on at the same time.
Yeah. So they... They get out there and what happens here? He tries to warn the king.
Well, back at the party.
Oh yeah, okay.
Back at the party, the king has been drugged by the little sidekick guy.
Right.
And they take the king off to his room.
He needs to go
rest.
Go let him rest.
And that's where
they plan to just kill him, and take his place.
Right. And
but the king's got his knights guarding him.
Yes.
One of them is the director.
One of the knights is the main knight.
Mm-hmm. So they're guarding the king and. Mark wants to go over there and warn the king, and he finally convinces the knight, right, to let him...
Yes, he convinces them in some way that that there's been some...
Or to at least, go mm-hmm. warn him. And, he convinces them that the king's probably not there anymore because they took him away to kill
right.
him. So then the knight's like, okay, show me. Because at first he just...
The director notices that the fake
the
king...
Knight.
the knight... Director notices that the fake king does not have his royal ring on.
So then he believes him,
right?
And
he follows him into this
secret passage right behind the bed.
Yeah.
So they go into the secret passage and they find the real king.
Right, and he's
the bad guy. Mm-hmm. Well, okay, the fake king was the bad guy. The main bad guy has perfected his little transformation stuff.
Right.
And he has transformed himself into the king. So when he took the knights up to show them that the king was probably not there anymore or dead or something, they found the king and he was totally fine, but it wasn't the real king.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when he noticed that he didn't have his ring.
No.
Yeah.
No, it was before. It was prior to that.
No. It was right there. Then the knight was like, they were like, the king's fine. He's right there in the bed, chamber. And
he
was like,
right,
where's your ring, sire?
Yeah.
And he's like, what ring? Which was a stupid answer. You should have said,
I know. He's like, I took it off.
But no, he just said, what ring? And so right away they know he's not the real king. So then Mark is like, tell your men to follow me. And he goes through, he somehow knew there was a secret passage there. He goes through the secret passage behind the bed, and the knights follow him, and they find the secret room where the king is being held, and the sidekick, bad guy sidekick, I guess, is about to stick a knife or sword mm-hmm. through him. And, of course, they stop him and they grab him. And
meanwhile, the main knight put the fake king in... he basically had these... silly knights guard the fake king, and the silly knights did not.
Oh yeah, they let him go because he was the king,
like,
right?
Well, he was the king, wasn't he?
it was a comedic little bit there.
Was really funny.
So the bad guy who looks like the king got away. So they go out and find him, and I don't remember how he changes back to the bad guy, but anyway, he does, and it turns into a big sword fight.
Uh-huh.
Mark and the bad guy,
Mark
much like we had a sword fight in the
previous
one. Now we have another sword fight. And this sword fight ends up going through the portals.
Yes, and there are so many cool portal scenes. What's the first one? Well, we don't know in order, but I know they go through Jack the Ripper.
They go through Jack the Ripper. They go through Nosferatu.
By the way, guess who is in the little scene in Nosferatu?
Drew Barrymore.
Drew Barrymore, ladies and gentlemen.
Is one of the... there's like two girls in the bed and Nosferatu's about to get them.
Yeah,
and
one of them is Drew Barrymore. She's got this little bit part. It's really funny.
No lines or anything, just because it's a silent movie.
Yeah.
And they go through that scene and...
And then
Jack the Ripper gets pushed out of his scene into Nosferatu's scene.
Yes,
so that's
so
what happened to Jack the Ripper. And
and then they
go through a Godzilla scene.
Godzilla.
They go through and the best one, they go through Dawn of the Dead.
Oh,
the original
so
Dawn of
cool.
the Dead.
And Mark is dressed all in this disco outfit.
Yeah, for some reason he's dressed like Saturday Night Fever, but it's Dawn of the Dead.
If you notice, he's kind of always dressed kind of ritzy in each scene that he transforms into. It's really funny. Whatever.
And they're sword fighting amongst all these zombies, and then you have the guys, the special forces guys
like,
from Dawn of the
people?
Dead. I don't know, but they're awesome.
Bad.
They're bad.
And
Mark cuts a hand off one of the zombies.
Yes.
So there's the evidence that he needs
to get
her off from murder rap, and plus it's a severed hand, which is what she said did the murder. So perfect. So. They're sword fighting, and
he ends up killing the bad guy, and he's talking to Sarah, and they're like,
because they got back to
home.
The medieval area,
and then, yeah, they're back in the medieval area,
and that's probably where he killed. I don't remember.
And
that's
he kills them in the medieval area, I think. Okay. And then he's talking to Sarah and explaining.
One of those mutant creatures he made gets a hold of him.
Yeah.
Of the bad guy,
and and Sarah ends up coming into her own again and killing the sidekick guy while all this is happening. I think that's what happened.
Yeah. Well, anyway, they get back to the real world with that hand.
But not before they go through the body snatchers scene.
That's not during the sword fight?
No, he's just showing Sarah. He opens up a little vortex and he shows Sarah. He like pushes her into the scene for a second, and you're almost like, "Why are you doing that?"
Yeah.
And then he's
like showing her.
And so she's seeing it. So when it's really cool because like when she gets into the scene, she's all dressed all 60s.
Or
50s, and then you see the
moving
people.
These pods through
the
streets.
Yeah, they're
and...
coming through. The pods are hatching, and she sees these pods, and she's like, "Oh my god!"
Yeah,
and she comes back
cool.
into the medieval times, and then and so they get back to the real world.
But he's telling her there. Like,
oh wait, no.
That they can't find the real door. These are all just leading
to
other scenes. I don't remember how he found the real door.
So he finds the door.
Somehow they find the real door.
Oh, it's a mirror. Sir Wilfred had given him another clue, and it was, something just guess.
It was another Alice in Wonderland.
Take a moment and guess, and it was the Red Queen
that
had said
that. Or through the looking glass, yeah.
And through the looking glass, and Sarah immediately knew that, and so they went through a mirror, and they opened the vortex through a mirror.
And then he says, it's too small, it's not big enough anymore for both of us.
For two people to come through. So he says his goodbyes to Sarah, and...
Because they took too long. I don't know why it was too small.
And
I don't remember. But...
She says, "I don't want to go on without you," and all this stuff. It's a really sad romantic moment. And then he just like kind of pushes her like gently. It's not
go
like
home,
a push.
Yeah.
And she kind of like goes through the thing. And
he's already kind of thinking. I think that he wants to stick around.
That he wants to be a time
and be a time warrior. But at the same time, it looked big enough. I don't know what the problem was. But anyway, supposedly it was too small for both of them.
But he's like, "I love you," and all this stuff.
Yeah.
And he gives her the hand. To take
for the trial, and she goes through, and she's back in the trial, and they're like, "With this evidence, we have to let you go because she's got a hand in a jar. It's all like the thing from Adam's family."
Uh-huh. And he's doing the little tapping thing
just,
on the jar.
It's in the jar like this. it's hilarious, and so she gets off, and she's going out of the trial in the cheesiest. Low budget looking scene where all these reporters and like the worst acting ever.
Yeah.
The reporters
really
like, "What are you gonna do now, Sarah? What are you gonna do now?"
Oh, wait, no. You forgot a big part.
Okay. Well, all the reporters are surrounding her and asking her stuff like that, though.
And
this one guy runs up.
This guy parts the crowd. And he's dressed in this, like, very established, like, British, almost 1920s look. I don't know why he looks like that. But he's kind of historical looking. And he hands her this
He's got a package.
Envelope.
An envelope.
Or a package, yeah.
A package.
And
it's and he's like, I'm from this delivery service.
Yeah, the
it's
oldest
exactly
delivery service. Total out of Back to the Future 2.
The end of Back to the Future 2. I'm from this, we're like the oldest delivery service. We're like 200 years old or whatever. Or mm-hmm. more than that. No, like way more.
He wasn't and, from Wells Fargo though.
No. And he's like, and we've had this package for you for like all this
time.
Yeah,
he said we started off in Europe or something like that. And then
I just came up with a reason why this issue is a problem. They're not traveling through time for real. They're traveling through this other dimension.
Shh.
This is a big mess up. This is a big mess up.
No.
But anyway, so he supposedly they've had this package all this time. This is a very mixed up, like the whole idea of them traveling through time versus a parallel dimension. Because they even say the name of this dimension they're in. But anyway, so she opens the package and it's one of these time travel, it's a time travel device.
And he sees her all happy and he's like, well, I guess I've done what I've needed to do here or whatever. And then he walks off.
And then that reporter's like, what are you going to do now, Sarah? And she holds it up and says,
I'm going back.
And then
she gets in the taxi cab and leaves. And all of a sudden, instead of, it's my party, we break into
a classic 90s rap song. Those, you know, that whole period where every movie ended with a rap song that basically told you the plot of the movie you just saw.
Yeah, and I mean, you got that's character what it names, is. You got everything, and oh god, it was just like the chorus is ridiculous. Something about
I don't remember.
Something about going through time like a bug in a jar. Or something.
Wherever you go,
there you are.
It's goofy.
It's
but
really bad.
It's, you know, you've watched this like
and
really
they're showing the
cheesy
footage.
Movie and it's perfect.
Yeah, it works for it.
Yeah, and in the footage, like Zach Galligan and her, like
they're just dancing around
while they're playing this with the rappers.
Yeah,
it's just this ridiculous ending. It's pretty funny.
It's funny to watch.
And that is Waxwork 2, Lost in Time.
We got through it, guys.
We couldn't say everything we saw in that movie, and we've seen this like so many times, but there's so much in both of these movies, especially the second one. There's so many details and things.
Yeah, definitely.
If you're trying to explain the movie, and it's tricky, but
I mean, like we said, part one is the classic. You really need to see it. And just for the fun of it, see part two. I mean, and
it is fun. Part two is a lot of fun.
Don't take it too seriously. Just watch it.
Both of them are really fun movies.
Yes. Yes.
And they have their loopholes and stuff, their plot holes.
More so part two.
I mean,
than
they
part
have
one.
Their plot holes and things like that. And part two, way more so.
Yeah.
But both are quirky and just tons of fun. I mean, a lot of the horror films that I watch that have like little issues like that, I love.
They're endearing.
It's because they're a lot of fun and the characters are great. Now the second film, I mean, we should get our opinions on the second film. My opinion on the second film. I enjoy it a lot, and the more I watch it, the more I enjoy it. I forget about some really great stuff. The Bruce Campbell stuff is
some
great.
Some of the scenes are shot incredibly. I mean, it's really good.
The concept is just so much fun, and it's a lot like Sliders and Quantum Leap, but more with monsters and sci-fi and horror and more horror kind of. They still kind of stick to horror themes.
Plus, I just love the idea
second
of
one,
Zach
but it's
Galligan
just less
being a time warrior.
Yeah, I mean, it's cool concepts like that. It's a, you know, time warriors and things like that. That's cool, you know. And it's got a lot of humor. The second one's got a lot more. The thing about the first one is there are actually some creepy, like really scary scenes in the first one.
Oh, I think there's some.
If you watch it with
the
lights out and you're, the second one, scary scenes? Not to me.
I would say that the one scary scene in the second one was, and I wouldn't say scary, but creepy is the haunting scenario.
Yeah.
They had a lot of
it has moments. The first one though, I always, at least ever since I was a kid, you know, I thought that werewolf scene was really cool and creepy, you know.
Yeah.
And maybe it's because I was a kid, I don't know. I can get lost in those scenes and imagine myself in the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I can find some, because some people don't find werewolf movies scary, and I can even find American Werewolf in Paris scary.
Oh, I love American Werewolf in Paris.
Paris.
Oh, you said Paris?
If I lose myself in a couple of scenes and imagine myself in that scene, I can get the horror vibe. That movie's got a lot of problems. We need to watch it.
We are going to watch it.
Yeah,
but I was a kid. I loved that movie mainly because of Tom Everett Scott. But I also love that movie. But I rewatched it like a year ago.
It's got a lot. I'm not
it's
saying
not
it's
not American Werewolf in London.
Oh
at all.
God, no, no. That's my favorite horror film is American Werewolf in London. Yeah. But American Werewolf in Paris, I can say some good things about it, and we'll review that sometime. But
it's very 90s. I like it.
It's very 90s. Mm-hmm. This one still feels mostly 80s.
80s, yeah.
I don't even know when that rap stuff started.
Well, this one's getting more 90s.
It's more 90s. No, this one is 80s.
Yeah, that's 80s.
And it's totally 80s. This one, I still feel like it has some 80s feel.
It's like Batman.
Yeah. But yeah, even though that was a year before this one. But this one, it's already 92, but it's still pretty 80s.
Oh, Batman was a little earlier. Yeah.
I think 91, Batman. Oh, no, 89. No, Batman was 89. Yeah. That was still 80s.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I was going to say, I think if they had gotten the same girl back,
I think it would have been a lot better.
I would have much better feelings for the sequel
of
Waxwork 2. Now, I still love it, mm-hmm. and I don't think anything would have made me love it as much as the first. But that's hard to say. If they had the same girl, I might have.
I think what I'm able to do is I'm kind of able to separate the two films in a way that, like, one is horror and one is sci-fi in a weird, strange way. And I am able to separate them so much that the fact that they didn't recast the girl, the original Sarah, does bother me. But I'm able to kind of lose myself and be like, okay, you know, let's just still go through this movie and watch it and enjoy it.
And it's good. It's just, having seen the first one, mm-hmm. especially because we usually watch them back to back, you know, you want that same character back. And she doesn't even act like the same character, really.
Right. Oh, not
at all. It's like a different character.
Yeah.
Except for, you know, he keeps calling her Sarah, so you know.
They are so different in a way. I mean, they're similar, but they are very different. It's very strange how they were able to accomplish that, or maybe not accomplish what they were going for. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't know. I have issues with them changing Sarah. I read that it was, and this is kind of rumored because I don't know for sure, it was like on a web board. Somebody said it was because the original Sarah was dating the director, and they broke up before making the second film.
Drama.
So they ended up getting a different Sarah because she didn't want to come back for it.
Understand.
I don't know if there's truth to that, but that's what I read recently. But so, yeah, well, and I will say, though, because we keep referring to the second one as sci-fi, and it is because it's very Sliders.
But it has horror elements to it.
They still are, the scenes they're still going to are usually horror-related.
Kind of,
it's like, yeah, there's the alien scene, but that's also considered kind of a horror
What's
movie.
Funny is that I don't consider the Body Snatchers horror, really. But I know some
it's
like a hybrid.
It's that right in between. It's that sci-fi horror.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, yeah, I mean, you know, that's pretty much a horror movie. Mm-hmm. Alien is also considered
a horror,
sci-fi.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, and the other stuff was straight up horror. Frankenstein, the Haunting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's still trying to. It's just there's a lot of daylight and a lot of like campiness, and there's a lot of time travel talk.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very sci-fi overall.
But Bruce Campbell's in it, so who cares? It's awesome.
Waxwork 2, you definitely need to see it one time at least.
Yes.
And see how you feel about it. But the more I watch it, the more I like it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I said, my big issue is just that they recast the girl. I always have a little trouble with recasting.
Yeah, I know.
But in this case, she was also playing it. I mean, they always play a little different when they recast people, but she was really playing it different to me. And then she did, there was no attempt to look like the old one or anything.
No, and
so.
I did kind of miss that 50s feel that they had.
Yeah, and the movie didn't have much of that 50s noir style at all. There's a little bit at the beginning when they go to some of the same places.
Which they weren't in the real world very often anyway, so maybe that's why I didn't feel like it, but
yeah, it was mostly the, yeah.
But some of the scenes they went to were certainly 50s and 60s-ish, because that's when the original films were made.
But it was all over the place. I mean, like Dawn of the Dead, that was awesome.
Oh, that was so cool. In fact, I feel like watching Dawn of the Dead right now.
This is well worth watching. I mean,
yeah.
But the first one, is like, you got, if you like, you know, monster movies and horror movies, you got to see the first one. Waxwork.
Yay.
There's no S at the end, which I'm always
saying. I always say Waxworks, and I apologize for that.
It's
Waxwork. But I heard people say it in the movie as well, so.
Yeah.
It's a common mistake.
The Waxworks is, I mean, that's what you call those kind of places, and that's what you call the statues. But yeah, it's Waxwork, and this, like we said, guys, this is coming out on Blu-ray.
Hey, guys.
October 17th. It will be the double feature that you see here.
You guys should really buy it.
But on Blu-ray, presumably widescreen, because it's Blu-ray, so it's got to be, right? And it will be unrated, and there will be cool bonus features, as I read recently.
Awesome.
So, and it will be a limited edition, so who knows how many, so jump on it.
Yeah.
I hope I'm not broke when it comes out, because
I
want it badly.
I'll give you this when I get it.
Like,
make it a part of your Halloween tradition. Mm-hmm. We have, and it's amazing, and you really should check it out.
Yeah, you at least want to watch this in October, but we watch this all the time.
All the time.
So, yeah. So that's Waxwork and Waxworks 2. And we're going to try to watch like a lot of like scary movies and Halloween stuff.
A lot of Halloween movie reviews coming up soon.
So we're going to plug away those. I want to do some Halloween specials. We were going to tack one onto this, but yeah, we might do those a little bit closer to Halloween.
Yeah, I think
but
so.
Yeah, we're going to do, you know, Halloween specials, because I love, you know, all that stuff, Charlie Brown and all that stuff. So yeah, we're going to do as much as we can. Of course, you know, some of it's going to be next year and next Halloween.
And a lot of it's going to be some obscure stuff. Like, I don't know if you guys have seen one of our favorite films.
Oh, what are you talking about? The Worst Witch or something?
Well, Worst Witch.
Oh, Midnight Hour?
Midnight Hour.
Oh, yeah. Which we don't have on DVD, but luckily I have it like downloaded
Midnight
somewhere.
Midnight Hour.
But,
you guys should see that.
Yeah. If you want to watch it ahead of time.
That is our Halloween
look
movie.
That up. It's on YouTube. Midnight Hour is on YouTube. The DVD is out of print. It has been for like a long time. I never managed to get that. Wow. I don't know if it'll ever come out again. And yeah, it's one of those where if you go on eBay, it's like gonna be over $100 to get the DVD.
But it's fantastic.
But it's on YouTube. Search Midnight Hour. It's the one with LeVar Burton from Reading Rainbow. So then you'll know you're watching
and,
right.
And Michelle Pfeiffer's sister. So
and
you
Michelle
can see if you can pick which one it is.
There are two girls in that movie. One of them looks like Michelle Pfeiffer. One of them is Michelle Pfeiffer's sister. They're not the same person. It's really weird and confusing.
Yes.
But we're gonna get into it. We're gonna review that. That one is more Halloweenish. We should do that closer to Halloween, but I don't want to like run out of time. So yeah,
we'll figure it out.
We're gonna see what we can do.
But yeah, let us know what you guys think of Waxwork.
Yeah.
I mean, check it out and
subscribe.
Comment.
Click the like button.
Yes.
Comment. Come on, guys.
Do all that good stuff. I mean, seriously, we want to know what you think.
Yeah.
I mean,
you want to suggest movies
to review?
I have a pretty big library. I don't know. I don't have everything, but you know. If we get a lot of requests and we have it, we might watch it.
Yeah, totally.
So, yeah. Okay, so we'll be back with more stuff later, guys.
Bye.
See ya. Bye.